W.F. House presents an unabridged recording of The Prostrate Years by Sue Townsend, narrated by Kris.
2007. Saturday, the 2nd of June, 2007. Black clouds over Mangold Parva. It has been raining since the beginning of time. When will it stop? Major worries. 1. Glenn fighting the Taliban in Helmand Province. 2. The bookshop only took £17.37 today. 3. Up 3 times last night to urinate. 4. The Middle East. 5. Do my parents have an up-to-date funeral plan? I can't afford to bury them. 6. My daughter, Gracie, showing alarming starless traits. Is this normal behaviour for the under fives? 7. It is 2 months and 19 days since I last made love to my wife, Daisy. I sometimes feel that she is less keen on me than she used to be. She hasn't taken the top off my boiled egg for ages. She's still not bought a pair of Wellingtons, despite living in Mangold Parva for 3 years. She is the only mother outside the school gate wearing 5-inch heels. This shows her total lack of commitment to me and to the English countryside. In the first month of our marriage, we picked blackberries together and she had a stab at making preserves. Now, 4 years on, the scars from the boiling jam have almost completely healed and she's buying raspberry Bon Maman at £3.50. It is ridiculous when you can buy the Co-op's own brand at 87p. Yesterday I found her crying over her old briefcase. When I asked her what was wrong, she sobbed, "I miss Dean Street." "Who's Dean Street?" I asked. She slammed the briefcase down and savagely kicked out at a bag of John Innes. "Dean Street, the place, idiot," she said in that calm, sarcastic voice I've come to dread. But at least she is speaking to me, although she's still avoiding eye contact. Last week, while searching for my nostril hair clippers in my wife's handbag, I came across a paper chase A5 size notebook with a cover depicting harmless looking monsters. On opening the notebook, I was startled to find on the first page a note addressed to me. "Adrian, if you have found my diary and you are reading this, do not read any further. This diary is my only confidant. Please respect my wishes and allow me some privacy. Close the notebook and replace it now." I read on. "Dear Diary, I intend to write in you every day and I will hold nothing back. I can tell no living person how I feel. Adrian would have a nervous breakdown. My parents and sisters would say we told you not to marry him, and my friends would say we told you so. But the truth is, Diary, that I am utterly miserable. I hate living in yokel land where the populace have never heard of the White Cube Gallery or macchiato coffee and think that Russell Brand is a type of electric kettle. Do I love my husband? Have I ever loved my husband? Can I live with my husband until one or both of us are dead?" I heard the back door slam and Daisy came in from the garden. I quickly replaced the diary in her handbag and for some reason shouted, "Daisy, when is the Queen's official birthday?" She came into the living room and said, "Why do you want to know? You haven't written her one of your poems, have you?" As she bent her head to light a cigarette, I couldn't help but notice that she now has 3 chins. I've also noticed recently that she has tampered with our Speak Your Weight bathroom scales, so that they no longer speak. I have stopped accompanying her to the shops to buy clothes, since she had a temper tantrum in the changing room at Primark, when she got stuck in a size 14 shirt and had to be cut out of it by the manageress. All the way home she was saying, "I can't understand it, I'm only a size 12. Even my friend Nigel, who is blind but can see shapes, said recently, "By Christ, Daisy's piling on the pounds. She came to see me the other day and I thought it was my garden shed on the move." When she went into the kitchen, I was tempted to grab her diary and read on, but I didn't risk it. After dinner, tinned tuna salad, new potatoes, beetroot salsa, own strawberries, elm leaf cream, I was washing up when Daisy came in and took a packet of chocolate digestives from out of the cupboard. Later, after I cleaned the kitchen surfaces and pushed the wheelie bin and the recycling boxes to the end of the drive, I went into the living room to watch Channel 4 News and couldn't help but notice that Daisy had eaten 3/4 of the packet of biscuits. I should not have said anything. I should have kept my mouth firmly shut. The subsequent row was like the eruption of a volcano. Gracie turned the volume up to full on her DVD of High School Musical 2 and demanded, "Stop shouting or I'll call the police." My mother came round from next door to find out if Daisy had actually killed me. She brought the row to an end by shouting above Daisy and me, "Daisy, you are in denial. You're obviously a size 16. Get over it. Evans, principals and even Dawn French supply clothes for fat women." Daisy hurled herself into my mother's arms, and my mother indicated with an angry gesture of her head that I was to leave the room. This morning, Daisy did not stand at the door and watch me mount my bike as I left for work as usual, and when I reached the lane and turned to wave, she was not at the window. Physically, I'm at a low ebb. I rise from my bed at least 3 times during the night, more if I allow myself a glass of wine after news night. Consequently, I'm exhausted, and the next morning I have to put up with my parents, with whom I share a party wall, complaining that the constant flushing of our cistern is keeping them awake. As I was cycling into a headwind, it took longer than usual to ride to the bookshop, and when I reached the environs of Leicester, I was further delayed. It seemed that every major road had been dug up, so that new sewage pipes could be laid. As a reluctant cesspit owner, this prompted me to be almost consumed with jealous rage. Is it any wonder my wife is yearning for the metropolis? I have denied her one of life's basic necessities. I blame my father for our primitive sanitary conditions. The money we put aside for mains drainage when we built the piggeries was frittered away on wheelchair ramps for him. Yet it was his own fault he had a stroke. The only exercise he took for years was wagging his index finger on the remote control. To add insult to injury, he still smokes 30 cigarettes a day and gorges himself on fried bread and chili-flavoured pork scratchings. I rue the day my parents bought 2 dilapidated pigsties and converted them into living units. I was grateful to have the pigsty roof over my head in the early days of my insolvency, but I've certainly paid the price. Another worry is my failure as a father. Gracie came home from nursery school yesterday with a felt-tip drawing of my family. Diary, I looked amongst the stick people for the representation of myself, but failed to find me. I was deeply hurt by my absence. When I asked Gracie why she hadn't included me, pointing out that it was the tax extracted from my wages that supplied her school with the felt-tips and paid her nursery teacher's salary, her brow furrowed. To avoid the usual escalation, sobs, screams, snot and recriminations, I diverted her by opening a pack of pink wafer biscuits. When I asked my wife why she thought Gracie had left me out of the family drawing, Daisy said, "She has obviously picked up on your emotional detachment." When I protested, she got ridiculously over-emotional and shouted, "When you come home from work, you sit and stare out of the window with your mouth open." I defended myself, saying, "I never tire of the view, the trees in the distance, the light fading from the sky." Daisy said, "It's not fucking Cornwall. The view from the front window is of a boggy field and a row of Leylandii your father planted to protect his privacy. Not that anyone comes near the place." Sunday the 3rd of June. 1. The old pigsty, the piggeries, bottom field, lower lane, Mangold Parva, Leicestershire. Sunday the 3rd of June, 2007. The Right Honourable Gordon Brown MP, Chancellor of the Exchequer, 11 Downing Street, London, SW1A 2AB. Dear Mr. Brown, I wrote to you at the Treasury recently regarding a great injustice. According to my local tax office, I am still in arrears to the sum of £13,137.11. This debt was incurred during a time when I worked for a duplicitous employer as an offal chef in Soho. I realise that you were an incredibly busy man, but if you could find the time to cast your eye over my paperwork, sent 1st of March 2007 by registered post, and then forward me a note confirming my innocence in this matter, I would be eternally grateful. Your humble and obedient servant, A.A. Mole. P.S. May I suggest that you sort this out before you take over as Prime Minister? P.P.S. Congratulations on doing so well with only one eye. You join the ranks of other illustrious one-eyed men. Peter Falk, Columbo, George Melly, Nelson, and of course, Cyclops. Monday the 4th of June. What started as a minor disagreement about the correct way to boil potatoes, I cook them from cold, Daisy throws them into boiling water, turned into a tearful and angry denunciation of our marriage. The list of my marital crimes included eating crisps too loudly, ironing creases down the front of my jeans, refusing to pay more than £5 for a haircut, wearing the same poppy, first purchased in 1998, during the month of November every year, putting too many dried herbs in spag bol, writing mad letters to famous people, failing to earn enough money to enable us to move out of the pigsty. At the end of her diatribe, I said, "I don't know why you married me." Daisy looked at me as if seeing me for the first time and said, "I honestly don't know why I married you. I suppose I must have loved you." "Loved?" I queried. "Did you mean to use the past tense?" Daisy went mad again, shouting, "Our marriage is breaking up and all you can do is talk about my grammar." "That's grossly contrapositional of what I actually said," I protested. "Listen to yourself," she said. "Nobody speaks like that, Adrian. Nobody actually says contrapositional." "Contrapositional almost certainly makes up part of Will Self's daily intercourse," I said. Even to my own ears, I sounded like Mr. Pooter. I do not enjoy such confrontations. Am I turning into one of those middle-aged men who think the country has gone to the dogs and that there has been no decent music since ABBA? Tuesday, 5th of June. Diary, I've been thinking about yesterday's entry, and I'm a little disturbed to find that I think the country has gone to the dogs and that there is nobody to beat ABBA. Wednesday, the 6th of June. The sun came out today. I do not mean in the metaphorical sense. I mean the actual sun came out from behind the low grey clouds that had been hanging about for months. The smell of hawthorn was thick in the air and most of the water had evaporated from the potholes in our drive. I remarked to Daisy that the sunshine would do us all good, boost our serotonin levels and prevent rickets. Daisy said, "All that sunshine means to me, Adrian, is that I have to shave my legs." She is not the woman I married. The old Daisy, who delighted in the sun, would be lying on a towel in a bikini on the flat roof of our pigsty to soak up every last ray. When I suggested she could sunbathe, her eyes filled with tears. "Have you seen the size of me recently?" she said. Diary, what has happened to my wife? Does she mean what she wrote about me in her notebook? Will we ever have sex again? Even my parents manage it every other Thursday. I have to wear earplugs because of the disturbing noises through the party wall. Monday, 11th of June. Mr. Carlton Hayes is ill. Leslie, his friend, rang me at the bookshop first thing this morning. For years I've been wondering if Leslie is a man or a woman. I am still none the wiser. Leslie could be a deep-voiced woman, a la Ruth Kelly, the cabinet minister, or a high-voiced man like Alan Ball, the footballer. All I know about Leslie is that he stroke she shares a house with Mr. Carlton Hayes, is unsociable, and has a liking for Sibelius and the pink coconut and licorice ones in a box of Bassett's all sorts. I asked Leslie what was wrong with Mr. Carlton Hayes, and he stroke she said, "Oh, did he not mention it? Oh, dear. I'm afraid I'm going to give you rather bad news. Oh, dear." I said hastily, "I'll wait, shall I, until he's better?" I could hear Leslie breathing. It sounded as if he stroke she had a bad chest. A customer, a woman with one large eyebrow, asked me if we stocked anything on the early surrealists. I directed her towards a Man Ray biography. I was glad of the temporary diversion. I kept Leslie on hold and gave the eyebrow woman the hard sell. Mr. Carlton Hayes had badly misjudged the interest for books about early surrealists in Leicester, and the 5 copies of The Man Ray had been hard to shift. On the other hand, he had severely underestimated the demand for Wayne Rooney's ghosted autobiography. When I returned to the phone, Leslie had gone. I meant to ring back immediately, but the woman came to the till with The Man Ray. When she had left, I dialed Leslie's number, but after only 2 rings, I put the phone down and disconnected the call. Sunday the 17th of June. Father's Day. Woken up at 6:20 this morning by the smell of burning, and Gracie yelling into my right ear, "Wake up, Dad! It's Father's Day!" Rushed into the kitchen to find smoke pouring out of the toaster, cornflakes underfoot, milk spilt on table, butter knife in sugar bowl. Gracie ordered me to sit down at the table and gave me a card she'd made with Daisy's help. Quite frankly, Diary, I was distinctly underwhelmed. A piece of card had been folded in half and the word Dad written in bits of pasta, most of which had fallen off, leaving only traces of glue. Inside it said, "Form Gracie." I gently pointed out to her that "from" was misspelled. She frowned down at the card and said defiantly, "Well, that's how children spell from in America." I said, "I think you might be wrong there, Gracie." She said, "Have you been to America?" I had to admit that I had, in fact, never been to America. Gracie said, "Well, I have. I went with Mummy one day while you were at the bookshop." I let it go. She is a formidable opponent. I am now regretting having volunteered to be the writer, stroke director, and producer of the Mangold Parva Players. Rehearsals are not going well. I break into a sweat when I realise we have only got 11 months before the opening night. 1. The Old Pigsty, The Piggeries, Bottomfield, Lower Lane, Mangold Parva, Leicestershire. Dear Sir Trevor Nunn, your name has been passed to me by Angela Hacker, the author and playwright, who is a neighbour of mine. I have written a play, Plague, set in the medieval countryside. It is an elegiac piece and features 60 human actors and quite a few animals, mostly domestic. Angela thought you might be able to give me a few tips on handling such a large cast. As you cannot fail to see, I have enclosed Plague for your perusal. If you would like to get involved, please let me know as soon as possible. I remain, Sir, A.A. Mole. Scene 1. A storm. A group of monks enter, wearing habits and sandals. A more distinguished monk is carrying a casket. This is Abbot Gottfried, a holy monk aged about 50. Note to stage management, a vacuum cleaner with the pipe in the blowhole set at the side of the stage can create the wind of the storm. Abbot Gottfried. Hark, brother, the wind doth blow very hard. Methinks we must take shelter in this cursed place. A yokel appears. He is called John and is going home for his dinner of maize dumplings in pig's ears broth. Abbot Gottfried. Halt, yokel! Where is thou goeth with such haste? Yokel John. I be going home to my dinner, holy one. Abbot Gottfried. What be this foul place called? Yokel John. 'Tain't got no name. 'Tis just an hill and a few fields and a novel or two. Abbot Gottfried. In a storm, a hovel is as meritorious as a palace, yokel. They have reached the village square, where 35 assorted men and women are standing around. A pack of dogs enter from stage left and cross. Chickens peck between the villagers' feet. Abbot Gottfried holds the casket aloft. He is followed by a fat monk, Brother Duncan, who enjoys bird-watching, and a thin monk, Brother Andrew, who suffers from panic attacks. Yokel John. What have you in the box? Abbot Gottfried. I have the entrails and anus of King John. The villagers and animals fall to their knees. Abbot Gottfried. His heart was buried at York, and this benighted place, methinks, will serve the king's anus well. The villagers cheer, and the dogs bark. End of scene 1. Monday, the 18th of June. I've just seen a photograph in an old copy of the Leicester Mercury of a bloke called Harry Plant, who was celebrating his 109th birthday. 109! He fought at the Battle of Passchendaele in the Great War when he was 19. Mr. Plant had a full head of hair. In fact, he could have done with a haircut. I wonder what his secret is. 1. The old pigsty, the piggeries, Bottomfield, Lower Lane, Mangold Parver, Leicestershire. The Willows Nursing Home, Bevan Road, Dewsbury, Leeds. Dear Mr. Plant, congratulations on reaching the grand age of 109. I wonder if you would mind letting me in on the secret of your longevity. I'm particularly interested in how you managed to retain your hair. Advice on diet, habits, etc. would be most gratefully accepted. I remain, sir, your most humble and obedient servant, A.A. Mole. A letter in quivery writing. Dear Mr. Mole, I thank you for your kind interest. I have no dietary habits. I just eat the food of the average Englishman. As for my hair, I pulverise an onion and apply the juice to my scalp before retiring for the night. With regards from Mr. Plant. 1. The old pigsty, the piggeries, Bottomfield, Lower Lane, Mangold Parver, Leicestershire. The Willows Nursing Home, Bevan Road, Dewsbury, Leeds. Dear Mr. Plant, thank you very much for your reply to my letter of Monday. I wonder if you would indulge me further by advising me on what type of onion you use. I look forward to your reply. Yours, A.A. Mole. Tuesday, the 19th of June. Today I asked Daisy if she would consider playing Eliza Hepplethwaite, the village whore, in Plague. I told her that she would have to wear red stockings and a matted hair wig, stick on warts and have her teeth blackened. I said, remember, Plague is set in pre-Colgate days. Daisy said, would it surprise you if I said no? Ask Marlene Webb from the boarding kennels. Her teeth are positively medieval. I said, I confess myself bitterly disappointed, Daisy. I had hoped that you would support my theatrical activities. Don't tell me that Plague is no good. It's the best thing I've ever written. I gave a copy to the vicar, and he wrote to congratulate me. I took the note out of my wallet and showed it to Daisy. Dear Adrian, a short note. I'm stunned. Congratulations on the first draft of Plague. It's quite an achievement to give over 60 cast members at least 2 lines each. I fear a prior commitment prevents me from accepting your kind offer to play Daft Dick. I have, as you requested, passed the script on to my wife. She says she will read it when she has finished working her way through the complete Iris Murdoch. Yours in God, Simon. Wednesday, the 20th of June. Tony Blair is flying around the world on his farewell tour. My mother says she half expects him to break into my way at the top of the aeroplane steps. Watched a Channel 5 documentary about an American woman, the fattest woman in the world, with Daisy. The woman, named Cindy Lou, cannot move from her reinforced bed. She is so gargantuan that her nightgown is made up of 2 king-size sheets stitched together. Daisy said, I could land up like Cindy Lou if I'm not careful. Sunday, the 24th of June. Rain torrential. When will it stop? Woken by church bells at 7 a.m. As usual, felt guilty for not going to church, even though I am 20% agnostic and 80% atheist. Went back to sleep, woken again by phone. It was Glenn in Afghanistan, using up some of his free family contact time. He asked me to give a girl what I met in Dude's nightclub my BFPO address. I can't get her out of my head, Dad. I think she might be the one. When I asked him for the girl's name and address, he said, I couldn't hear, Dad, the music was too loud. But if you happen to come across Tiny Curtis, the head bouncer at Dude's on Saturday night, can you pass this message on? Have you got a pen or pencil, Dad? I scrabbled in the bedside drawer, but could not find a single writing implement that worked. Conscious that precious seconds were ticking away, I reached for Daisy's black eyeliner pencil, which is never far from her side, even when asleep, and took down the following message. Yo, Tiny, how's it hanging, bro? Do you remember that girl I was with last time I was in? Well, can you tell her I think she's lush, and that I wanted to write to me in Afghanistan? Tell her to send a photo. Thanks, bro. You would think the boy had grown up in Harlem rather than a post-war council estate in Leicester. I protested to Glenn that I was never likely to come across Tiny outside dudes on a Saturday night, since I never went into the city centre after dark if I could help it. Glenn said, please, Dad, it could be the last thing you ever do for me. The Taliban is closing in. I could hardly refuse. Walked under dripping trees into Mangold Parva to the Bear Inn for lunch. My mother said, if the sun doesn't shine soon, the whole of England will have a nervous breakdown. Gracie refused to walk through the puddles in the lane, even though she was wearing her red boots for the first time, and demanded to sit on my father's lap in his wheelchair. My mother said, that child will never walk anywhere if you keep giving in to her, Adrian. And anyway, she won't be comfortable. There's not an ounce of fat on your father's legs now. Daisy said, leave her be, Pauline. She'll only kick off. I want to eat my lunch in peace. My mother stomped off ahead, muttering, you're making a rod for your own bleeding backs, as she attempted to light a cigarette in the stiff June gale. I was surprised to hear a cheer as we entered the pub. Surprised because the Mole family is not particularly popular around here since the incident with the wheelie bins. However, the cheer was for the news that Tony Blair had finally resigned as leader of the Labour Party and will be standing down on Wednesday as Prime Minister. I should have been joining in the cheers. Instead, I felt tears prick my eyes. Mr. Blair squandered my affection and respect for him on a war that killed my son's friend. I was transported back to that glorious May Day when cherry blossom floated in the spring sunshine, as if the trees were throwing confetti to celebrate New Labour's victory. I was young then, and full of hope and believed that Mr. Blair, with his mantra of education, 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 would transform England into a land where people at bus stops spoke to each other of Tolstoy and post-structuralism. But it was not to be. My own father thinks that Tate Modern is a new type of sugar cube. As we took our places in the carvery queue, my mother rhapsodised about Gordon Brown, saying he was dark and craggy and solid. Daisy broke off from comparing the relative succulence of the beef, pork, lamb and turkey joints and said, the north face of the Eiger is craggy and solid. The difference is, the north face has more emotional intelligence. Daisy claims that when she was a PR girl in London, rumour had it that Gordon Brown had a syndrome of some kind. My mother said that Gordon Brown still had all the qualities she looked for in a man. He was introverted with an air of menace about him, just like Mr. Rochester in Jane Eyre. My mother is getting quite literary lately. She's reading 4 novels a week in preparation for writing her autobiography. Ha, ha, ha. Lunch at the carvery was adequate, but I still miss my grandmother's Sunday dinners. No carvery can replicate her crisp Yorkshire pudding and her rustling roast potatoes. As we were hacking at our meat, we had all gone for the beef apart from Gracie, who had the pirate special, fish fingers and an eye patch. My father said, I've been working it all out in my head. It costs us as good as £6 each for this bloody muck, and Gracie's was near on £4. That's £28. How much is a decent joint of beef? He looked at my mother and Daisy. They stared back at him blankly. Neither of them appeared to know. A bit of beef, a few vegetables, my father said. He's making a profit out of us. He resumed scraping the last vestiges of gravy from his plate. I said, but that's capitalism. I thought you approved of the capitalist system. Or have you had a change of heart? Was this failure to grasp the basic rules of business an early sign of Alzheimer's? Tom Urquhart, the landlord, strolled over. For some reason, he has never liked our family. I haven't had a proper conversation with him since the day I asked him if he would install a disabled toilet for my father. pathetic excuse was. A disabled toilet would spoil the character of the pub. The bear has been here since before the monasteries were dissolved. When I pointed out to him that Cromwell's army had a high incidence of disability, it was rife with amputees, he turned his back on me and started fiddling with the optics behind the bar. We had run out of gravy, but I didn't want to ask Urquhart. Instead, I went to the kitchen door with the empty jug and was shocked at the sight of Kath Urquhart, the landlady, having the back of her neck kissed by Jamie Britton, the trainee chef. I quickly moved away from the door, but I think they may have seen me. I returned to our table with the empty jug, much to my mother's disgust. My father whined, "I'll go myself, but I don't know if my wheelchair will fit through the gaps between the tables." My mother grabbed the empty jug and almost ran towards the kitchen, disappeared through the door, and then reappeared only half a moment later. I searched for a sign that she had witnessed more of Mrs. Urquhart's scandalous behaviour, but her face was its usual mask of Max Factor foundation and disappointment with life. Monday, 25th of June. Rained all day. The brook at the end of our field is babbling. My mother asked me if she thought our field would flood. I reassured her that according to Tony Welbeck in the post office, our field had only flooded a few times in the last 10 years. A letter from Mr. Plant. "Dear Mr. Mole, Spanish, yours, Mr. Plant. P.S., please do not write to me again." Tuesday, 26th of June. Today is Mr. Blair's last day as Prime Minister of Great Britain. I expect he will have a full day trying to repair his reputation. Perhaps he will visit a hospital and see some of the badly injured soldiers who served in Iraq. On his last day in office, Mr. Blair entertained Arnold Schwarzenegger. When I look at Mr. Blair now, I see a weak man who took us into a war because of his own personal vanity. Everything he did for the country seems to be unravelling. I am an atheist, but should it turn out there is a God, I might think that he had arranged for biblical rain to fall on Blair's legacy of sin. Casinos, television pornography, binge drinking, knife crime, and instant credit. I have great hopes for Mr. Brown, a man of substance, gravitas, and numeracy. I think he is a secret socialist who will go into number 10 much as Clark Kent went into a phone box. I am convinced that Mr. Brown will emerge as Superman. My mother is obsessed with misery memoirs. She's currently reading A Child Called It. She said tonight, "I could write a book." I expect she thinks it will validate her life. Wednesday, 27th of June. The country is on flood alert. The people of Hull are already experiencing the worst. Went round to see my parents and pay them our share of the mortgage. The television news was on. I studied the new incumbents as they stood outside number 10 on Mr. Brown's first day of office. He looked as if he had had a mouth transplant and was trying his smile out for the first time, and his wave was pathetic. My mother said, of Mrs. Brown, "Poor Sarah, those two little kids to look after, a workaholic husband, and all those canapes to arrange and dignitaries to meet." I said, "Why are you calling her Sarah? You don't know her." My mother said, "All women are sisters to me. That's something you'll never understand, Adrian." My father said, "She looks like a decent sort of woman, and at least she's got a normal-sized mouth on her." So Gordon Brown is now the captain at the helm of this country's ship. Let us hope he will steer Great Britain away from the rocks so that we may voyage on calm and prosperous seas and towards the light at the end of the tunnel. I expect Mr. Brown to denounce Tony Blair's decision to invade Iraq any day now. Still raining. River Sense, high. It has broken its banks in places. I've had to micturate 12 times today. 9 p.m. Won the old pigsty, the piggeries, Bottom Field, Lower Lane, Mangold Parva, Leicestershire. Wednesday, the 27th of June, 2007. The Right Honourable Gordon Brown, Prime Minister and First Lord of the Treasury, 10 Downing Street, London, SW1A, 2AA. Dear Prime Minister, a quick note to ask if you have had a chance to glance at the papers concerning my tax affairs. Yours, a concerned citizen, A.A. Mole. Thursday, 28th of June. Daisy has joined Weight Watchers at the village hall. I had to give her a lift on the back of my bike because she will not wear Wellingtons and the lane is flooded due to the non-stop rain. It wasn't worth going home again, she was only going to be an hour, so I arranged to meet her in the Bear after she'd been weighed and done whatever else it is that Weight Watchers do. Daisy came in and slumped down next to me saying, I'm 13 stone, 12 ounces. She lit a cigarette. 13 stone, 12 ounces, is that good or bad? I asked. It would be great if I were a light heavyweight boxer, she said. But as I'm only 5'3" and small boned, yes, it is a bad thing. A very bad thing. She picked up my beer glass and drained the contents, then wiped her mouth with the back of her hand and said, I was 9 stone 1 pound on my wedding day. I could see that she was descending into one of her depressions, so I said, there's more of you to cuddle now. That obviously didn't help. I went to the bar to get her a double vodka and tonic, drinking straw but no ice, no lemon. A group of hefty women in tracksuits bulged into the pub and crowded round a small table where they all lit cigarettes. The bar soon resembled the last scene of Casablanca, with fog on the runway. Are they your fellow Weight Watchers? I asked. No, said Daisy, who knew everything that was happening in the village. They're training for a sponsored run to raise money to save the post office. Save it from what? I asked. Closing, said Daisy, lighting yet another cigarette. I said, you've just put one out, and that was only half smoked. She replied, quite savagely, considering we were in public, Listen, Mr. Clean Lungs, on Sunday it will be against the fucking law to smoke a fag in a pub. I'm getting as many in as I can before then. To divert her, I brought us back to our conversation about the post office. It can't close, I said. I use it at least 3 times a week, and what about Dad? It's his only regular outing. He loves pension day. Daisy slammed her glass down and shouted to Tom Urquhart behind the bar, You can feed a newborn baby on this Stolichnaya. You're not supposed to water it down. It's not Rose's effing lime juice. I sometimes wish that Daisy had not been brought up to be a free spirit, and had learnt to be inhibited in public. She didn't care that Urquhart was muttering about her, or that everyone in the pub was looking at her. I approached the tracksuited women to ask if I could join the Save the Post Office campaign. I explained that due to personal reasons, I was unable to do a sponsored run, gesturing vaguely at my legs. I know who you are, said one of the women, wearing a pink and white tracksuit the exact shade of coconut ice. I've seen you at the school gate. You live in one of them pigsties. You're writing the community play. Can we all have a part? I told them that I would write a scene for them, and they laughed and did high fives with their porky arms across the table. 10 p.m. On our way home, the rain was thundering onto the umbrella. Gibbet Lane was more puddle than road. I had to push Daisy most of the way. It was no easy matter having a light heavyweight boxer on the crossbar. I told her that unless she bought a pair of Wellingtons, I would... You'll do what? She said, her hands tightening around my neck. I did not reply. She knows I'm a fool for love. The field was so flooded that the water came ankle height up my Wellingtons, and I had to carry Daisy right up to the front door. As I was putting the key in the lock, my mother came up to her front door and said, I saw you staggering up the drive. Is she drunk again? Daisy slid off my back and said, Again, Pauline, again? I can't remember the last time I was drunk. I can, said my mother. It was yesterday. I nipped into Cadgerfag and you were lying on the settee. I was playing at casualty with Gracie, said Daisy heatedly. By now we were in the cramped hallway. I took off my sodden coat and trousers, put on my dressing gown and went into the living room. My mother and Daisy remained in the hall, having a whispered conversation. And then I heard my mother's raised voice. You might think you can fool him, Daisy, but you can't fool me. Before we went to bed, I checked the alcohol supplies in the kitchen cupboard. There was very little vodka left in the bottle, and all the leftover Christmas liqueurs and novelty drinks, Nigel's birthday gift of scorpion tequila, had gone. Friday the 29th of June. Mr. Carlton Hayes, who returned to work on Monday, said the incessant rain reminded him of the floods of 1953, when his aunt was swept from her bungalow in Skegness, carried downstream, and ended up on the roof of the bus station. He didn't say why he'd been away from the shop, but I noticed that he is walking very gingerly. Sunday the 1st of July. No smoking day. A momentous day. Smoking in a public place or place of work is forbidden in England. Though if you are a lunatic, a prisoner, an MP or a member of the royal family, you are exempt. Smoking has blighted my life. There is a photograph of me in my mother's arms the day I was released from the maternity hospital. She's standing in the hospital car park, with me cradled in one arm, the other arm is hanging at her side, and in her hand is a lit cigarette. I've been ingesting smoke since I was 5 days old. My childhood memories are clouded by smoke-filled rooms and car journeys made miserable by my chain-smoking parents. From my subservient position in the back of the car, I would plead for a window to be opened, but my father would refuse angrily, saying fresh air was bad for his bronchitic chest. I remember, on a long traffic-choked journey to Hunstanton, improvising a face mask out of a Kleenex man-sized tissue. My parents found this to be hilarious and called me Bandit Boy throughout our short stay. After breakfast, two Weetabix, chocolate croissant, banana, I went next door to invite them to Sunday lunch at the Bear. I said, I want to experience for the first time what it's like to enjoy a meal with you without both of you blowing smoke in my face. My father went into a rant, saying this bloody authoritarian government, they're a bunch of fascists, Nazis. My mother looked broken. This is a sad, sad day, she said. It's hardly the end of civilization, I said, as I went around the room emptying ashtrays into the pedal bin. My mother said, well, it's the end of my little world. She went into a lamentation about what will be lost. What will be lost, I said, will be your hacking cough, the foul stink, the experience, interrupting. My mother reached for her cigarette packet and said dreamily, I've smoked since I was 13. At 15, I wore 3/4-length gloves and used a tortoise-shell cigarette holder. They'd lynch you nowadays, my father said. Who would? I asked. Bleeding animal rights, tossers. Save the bloody tortoise. My mother continued. At 16, I was going to the Hot Sounds Jazz Club in Norwich. It was there I smoked my first disc bleu. I was on Capstan full strength by the time I was 16, boasted my father. I left them to their smoking reminiscences. I could hear Daisy and Gracie shouting at each other through the party wall. When I got in, I found them engaged in yet another ridiculous argument about clothing. Why does my daughter always have to be dressed as a Disney character of some kind? She's a merchandiser's dream. I still remember her first day at nursery school. Her pirate costume did not go down well with the reception class teacher, and it took forever to wrest the cutlass from her tiny fingers. Gracie shouted, why can't I wear my Tinkerbell costume to the pub? Daisy said, you can, but you're not wearing the wings. Fairies have to wear their wings or they can't fly, said Gracie. You're not wearing those bloody wings, said Daisy. The last time you wore them in the pub, they knocked every glass off the next table and it cost your dad 25 quid to replace the drinks. Gracie shouted, well, if my wings knock anything over today, I'll pay with my £1 million in the bank. Daisy and I looked at each other guiltily. We had pillaged Gracie's saving for the future bank account to pay the last electricity bill. She stomped off to her bedroom and returned wearing the Tinkerbell dress and wings. I did not have the heart to remonstrate. When Gracie said, I look beautiful, don't I? I weakened and said, yes. Daisy exploded, saying that I was ganging up against her and undermining her authority. I took a tea towel and began to dry the breakfast things that Daisy had left on the draining board, and remained calm as she berated me for actual and imaginary wrongs. It was a long and familiar list. The cesspit, the fact that she doesn't have a car, I earn a pittance at the bookshop, she is tired of colouring her own hair and the lack of Sky Plus, she hates the taste and texture of the bread I make twice a week, she thinks the villagers of Mangold Parva are imbeciles, she hates giving the pigsty address to anybody, she is sick of my parents interfering in our lives. She sat down at the kitchen table and began to cry. It was a heartbreaking sound, and I suddenly became afraid. Gracie wriggled out of the contentious Tinkerbell costume and waved the twinkly wand over her mother's head, as though magic would stop her tears. I don't know how I can make my wife happy. Gracie and I sat on our own for most of our meal at the Bear. Daisy and my mother and father were outside, smoking in the rain, together with most of the regulars. Tom Urquhart, the landlord, said, "This no-smoking malarkey is going to finish the Bear." I did not enjoy my meal. It was overcooked and had a curious texture that set my gag mechanism off. I suspect because Lee Grant, the chef, was constantly nipping out to have a cigarette. Also, Gracie kept up an interminable monologue about a boy at nursery school called Mason, who lives in one of the council houses. She told me that he has a packed lunch of 2 bags of crisps, a bottle of Coke, a bag of Haribo sweets and a cheese string. According to Gracie, Mason was made to stand in front of the assembled school while the contents of his lunchbox were displayed and condemned by Mrs. Bull, the headmistress. The box reference reminded me that it was months since I had last spoken to Pandora. I think about her several times a day, but I'm a proud man and I've been waiting for her to ring me. I saw that the smokers had been joined in the drizzle by Hugo Fairfax Lycett, the heir apparent of Fairfax Hall. As I watched, he lit Daisy's cigarette, and she threw her head back and did her party trick of blowing a succession of smoke rings. I saw the admiration on his face and watched as my mother undid the top button of her mock satin shirt. I don't see why women go so balmy about Fairfax Lycett. He is far too tall, looks like a ravaged Hugh Grant, and is vulgarly ostentatious with his sports cars and Savile Row tweeds. I bet he has never opened a book since leaving Cambridge. Pandora would make mincemeat of him. After an interminable seeming 10 minutes, I heard the roar of Fairfax Lycett's car and my family came back inside for their pudding. My mother pushed her soggy peach cobbler to one side of the bowl and said, "The food in this place has gone off." My father said, "Everything has gone off since New Labour took over. Do you know who owns our water now? The fucking French. And you can't even pick your nose in private anymore. There'll be a bloody CCTV camera watching where you put your bogeys. You've got nutters in Glasgow bombing the bleeding airport, and soon we're all going to be up to our waists in floodwater. What next?" Tony Welbeck from the post office said, "Foot and mouth, George. They've got it in Harton, less than a mile from Mangold." Diary, if somebody had walked into the pub and said, "There's a plague of locusts outside," I would not have raised an eyebrow. Is this the end of the world as we know it? Later, I was going to have it out with Daisy, but then I noticed she was reading For the Sake of Argument by Christopher Hitchens, and again decided against it. Monday the 2nd of July. Mr. Carlton Hayes phoned to say that he was incapacitated. I don't like it when he's not at the shop. It's not that he does very much these days, but I feel better when he's there. He truly loves books, to the detriment of the business. The other day, a middle-aged woman with John Lennon glasses and over-large breasts came in and tried to buy a second edition of The Mill on the Floss for £150. She introduced herself as Dr. Pierce and said she was looking for a retirement present for the head of the English department at De Montfort University. Mr. Carlton Hayes unlocked the glass cabinet where the antiquarian books are kept and took the 2-volume edition down from the shelf. He handed volume one to the woman, watched her leaf through it, and then took it back and replaced both books in the cabinet. When Dr. Pierce had left, empty-handed and bewildered, Mr. Carlton Hayes said, "I thought she handled it too roughly, as though the book were an RSPCA rescue dog." It's no wonder the accountants are advising him to sell the shop premises to Tesco. When he told me this, I saw a rare flash of anger pass over his face. He spread his arms out to the shelves and stacks of books and said, "But where would they go?" As though they were a displaced people. I took advantage of Mr. Carlton Hayes' absence, phoned De Montfort University and left a message for Dr. Pierce to the effect that the mill on the floss was now for sale. She came in only minutes before I closed. We talked about George Eliot and she seemed pleased to find a fellow enthusiast. It was 6:30 before I noticed the time. She waited while I locked up, then we walked down the high street together, me pushing my bike, she holding an umbrella over our heads. She kept me talking on the corner of the Holiday Inn car park for another half an hour. When Daisy asked why I was late home, I told her that the chain had come off my bike. Don't ask me why. Thursday, 5th of July. Mr. C.H. back. Received a disaster alert text on my mobile as we were eating our sandwiches in the back of the shop. 25 killed and 33 injured in an explosion in a karaoke bar in Tianshifu in China. "Shocking, isn't it?" I said to Mr. Carlton Hayes. "It is indeed," he said, sighing. "Karaoke in China. Weep, Confucius, weep." Friday, the 6th of July. Woken up by the phone. It was my mother. "Have you looked outside?" she shrieked. I took the phone and drew back the bedroom curtains. The fields had vanished and been replaced by shimmering floodwater as far as the eye could see. "Have you got any sandbags?" my mother asked. I said, "You know I haven't got any sandbags. Why would I have sandbags?" I phoned Mr. Carlton Hayes to tell him that I wouldn't be in today, and he said, "Yes, it was rather exciting driving through the floods. The water came up to the wheel arches of the Rover." I spent most of the rest of the day trying, canute-like, to prevent the water from breaching our doorstep. When the flood had receded somewhat, I sat down with Gracie to watch television. Postman Pat has been promoted. He's got to leave Greendale Village and his red van to move to a middle management position at the head office. Some fool at the BBC said, "We are taking Postman Pat into a dynamic new environment. There will be highly charged storylines." So even Postman Pat is sacrificed on the altar of progress. Without his uniform and his red van, Pat is nothing. Nothing. This is just a blatant attempt to exploit the commercial arm of the BBC. I expect there will be a new range of Postman Pat merchandise. Will I have to buy Gracie a Postman Pat Montego and a suit and a briefcase set? Wednesday, the 11th of July. Day off today. I intended to spend it diligently colour-coding my CDs and updating a few pages of my serial killer comedy, The White Van. I lay awake last night thinking about it. Obviously, Pauline Quirk and Harry Enfield are a bit old now to play the serial killer and his wife, but Russell Brand and Amy Winehouse would make good substitutes. I was also going to offer to do half the ironing, but something came over me and I did nothing but watch television. At 4 p.m. I tore myself away from Flogget. I really wanted to know how much a Clarice Cliff egg cup set went for at auction, and ran in my Wellingtons through the last few inches of floodwater to the post office to post a birthday card to my sister-in-law, Marigold, and a parcel for Daisy. She had eBayed her Louis Vuitton holdall to a woman in Nuneaton to pay the 7 Trent water bill before they cut us off. The postmaster and postmistress, Tony and Wendy Welbeck, were both behind the counter, bickering over the cost of airmail stamps to Timbuktu. I signed the Keep Our Post Office Open petition and waited. They both smiled politely when they noticed me at the counter. "Who in Mangold Parva is writing to Timbuktu?" I asked. Wendy looked around the post office, then lowered her voice and said, out of the corner of her mouth, I'm not allowed to say. Confidentiality or data protection. But if you nip out and look up Gibbet Lane... I went outside and saw old Mrs. Lewis Masters inching her way up the hill behind a Zimmer frame. Timbuktu? She looked like the type of woman who only ever wrote to some distant relation in Sydenham about knitting patterns and the trials of dealing with one's bank via their call centre at Calcutta. As she weighed Daisy's parcel, Mrs. Welbeck said, "She writes to Timbuktu once a fortnight, sends cards at Christmas and Easter and a birthday card in early July." The Mangold Parva post office is like an illustration out of one of Gracie's books. Apart from the fact that Mr. and Mrs. Welbeck are not squirrels in Edwardian clothing. Every inch of the interior is lined with shelving and stuff for sale, though I think the Welbecks lost control of their stock years ago. There are tins of beans next to a box of jiffy bags. Pots of pens and pencils share a shelf with tins of cat and dog food. Greetings cards are jumbled together in shoeboxes. A happy first birthday shares a box with condolences on your recent bereavement. The stationery shelves tempted me with their luscious, spiral-bound notebooks containing virginal white black-lined paper with margins in red. I was drawn to them as other men are drawn to adult toys in sex shops. "Another notebook," said Mrs. Welbeck. "What are you doing? Eating them?" "Mr. Mole's a bit of a writer," said Mr. Welbeck. Everything he said sounded faintly insulting, as though he was having a private joke. "I could write a book working here," said Mrs. Welbeck. "You wouldn't believe the things we see and hear." It is my habit to challenge people like Mrs. Welbeck, who make such empty boasts. "Why don't you write a book then?" I said. Mrs. Welbeck sighed. "I would if I had the time." "Wendy's a brilliant writer," said Welbeck. "Her letters are famous in the family." "A book is a very different thing though, isn't it?" I pressed. "A book needs structure, plot, characterisations." "A punctuation is second to none," said Welbeck. "She knows exactly where to place her full stops." "Then she must go ahead and write her book," I said. "I told you, I haven't got the time," she said quite irritably, I thought, considering I was a customer. "Why? What do you do with the hours you are not working?" I asked, genuinely wanting to know. "Well, I sleep for 8 of them," she said. "And the rest?" I asked. I couldn't stop, even though I could see that our conversation was leading to a confrontation about the artistic sensibility. "I cook, I clean, I wash, I iron, I do a daily Sudoku, I garden," she went on in this vein. I happen to know that Mrs. Welbeck is an ardent follower of various soap operas. I have often heard her talking proprietorially about characters in EastEnders, Coronation Street and Emmerdale. "And television?" I queried. "Does that take up the time when you could be writing?" Mr. and Mrs. Welbeck exchanged a glance. She'd been caught bang to rights. However, I felt no joy at my victory, and to show compassion to Mrs. Welbeck, I bought yet another notebook to add to my collection. On the way home, I easily overtook Mrs. Lewis Masters, who was still inching up Gibbet Lane in the rain. I walked at a funeral pace beside her, sheltering both of us from the heavy downpour under my umbrella. She looked a little afraid of me, and moved her handbag so that it hung on the other side of the Zimmer frame. I put her at her ease by discussing the merits of the hanging baskets, which were displayed on every cottage and lamppost. She looked at the floral baskets disdainfully. "Were I younger," she said, in an accent the Queen would have felt at home with, "I would steal out at night and destroy the gaudy horrors." She stopped and stared at some bright orange flowers that spilt out of a green plastic tub, hanging from a bracket on the wall of Pamper Yourself. "What are they?" I asked. "Begonias," she spat. "They are abominations. The Margaret Thatcher of the plant world. Shrill, domineering, ubiquitous." I looked at the old woman with new eyes. I would have put her down as a certain Thatcherite. Before we parted company at the top of the hill, I determined to find out why she regularly corresponded with somebody in Timbuktu. "Do you live far from here?" I asked. "No, that's my house there." "No, that's my hearth there." She nodded at an imposing, flat-fronted brick house at the crest of the hill. "So, not as far away as Timbuktu," I said, feigning a laugh. "Timbuktu," she said, lifting her head and focusing her grey eyes on me. "Why bring Timbuktu into the conversation?" I said, "It's an expression my father uses to denote distance." I wished her good day and hurried away. When I got home, I googled Timbuktu and learnt that it is the main city in the landlocked state, the French Sudan, where the river meets the desert. Arab tribes brought gold from the south and salt from the north. Once described as the place where the camel meets the canoe. Thursday, the 12th of July. Gracie had a horrible tantrum this morning, demanding that she be allowed to wear her Little Mermaid outfit rather than her school uniform. Daisy and I were quite helpless in the face of the child's rage. I explained that it would impede her movements, and the fishtail dragging through the puddles in the lane would prevent her from walking to school. Besides, Little Mermaid has to be carried everywhere, and they're lowered onto rocks. Gracie was screaming, "I am a fish! I can swim to school!" As I abandoned my wife to my by-now hysterical daughter, costumed in a half-bimbo, half-fish dress. It was pouring with rain again, but I didn't care. I would have cycled in a typhoon to get away from the din in that house. Mr. Carlton Hayes was away again. A young man in black square-framed glasses asked me if I had anything on tropical diseases. He looked a bit peaky, so I kept my distance and directed him to the medical shelves, where he opened Rapid Infectious Diseases and Tropical Medicine by Rachel Isba, read for 20 minutes looking increasingly worried, then hurried from the shop without buying anything. After he had gone, I sprayed the shop with Dettol antiseptic disinfectant, just to be on the safe side. I can't afford to be ill. Saturday, the 14th of July. Nigel rang me at work to tell me that he's in love with a fellow blind man. How stupid can you get? It would have been better all round if Nigel had fallen for a man with good eyesight. But as it is, Nigel and his new partner, Lance Lovett, will be blundering around, bumping into furniture, spilling drinks and walking into the traffic together. I told Nigel that he has made a rod for his own back. He said, "I've still got Graham to help me." I said, "Graham is a dog, Nigel, and he's on his last legs. It's not fair to expect him to look after two blind people. It's extra work for him. Don't feel sorry for Graham."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.